What is it like to own a DeLorean? So I just grab the strap and...
Yeah, just close it. Slam it.
Aggressively?
Yeah.
Will it take my head off?
Okay, way harder than that. There you go. Okay.
That's scary. It felt like it interfered with something.
Yeah, that kind of... So this is an early car.
Okay.
So this is VIN 2203. DeLorean started VIN 500.
Yeah.
So this is 1703rd car made.
Oh my God.
There's a fun story about VIN 500 and 501 that I can tell later.
Okay.
But the early cars, this being an 81... you know, they were still trying to work out some of the issues with the cars.
All right.
The later cars, like 83s, you can close the door with your pinky. They're phenomenal.
Really? They're like more well balanced?
Yeah.
Does this seat adjust that much?
Not a whole lot. It's about as far back as it goes.
All right, I fit. I mean, my head's touching the roof. All right, let's go.
All right, let me find out where I put the keys. All right.
Today, we're going to talk about what it's like to own a DeLorean. Well, technically, it's a DMC DeLorean, right?
DMC 12 DeLorean.
DMC 12 DeLorean.
Yep.
Here, Jace.
Yep.
And he's got this very cool, I mean, DeLoreans are cool overall. First, just they look awesome, but you've done some interesting things to it.
I have, yeah. So I wanted it to be kind of more of like a classic mod style, I guess you could say. Because I feel like a lot of people, they modernize DeLoreans and they put, you know, LED lights all over them and stuff, you know, which is cool and everything, but I kind of wanted it to modify it in sort of like a period correct kind of style.
Makes sense.
So I was really inspired by a lot of like the GT cars and stuff from like the late 70s and early 80s, you know, like the, you know, the Countach at the time and some of the old school Ferraris.
That sounds good.
Yeah. So this car features, it's kind of complicated, but the these are Porsche ITBs that are meant to be EFI replacements for like the classic Weber ITB carburetors.
Oh wow.
On like 60s and 70s 911s.
Okay.
So they're made by Borla. They're made for the 911, but I'm an engineer by trade, so I use my engineering skills for evil after hours. And I designed my own intake manifolds to allow us to bolt up the Porsche, you know, ITBs to the DeLorean head.
It looks really cool back there.
It does.
Yeah.
And my favorite part is you can see it in the rearview mirror when you're driving.
Really?
Yeah.
Nice.
It's just awesome.
What else? So powertrain, you're making a good amount of power because from the factory they were like
130.
They're like 130 horsepower? Yeah.
On a good day.
On a good day.
On a good day. And with the automatic, it was even worse.
Oh, God. The
speed. This car used to be an automatic.
Oh, did you manual swap it?
I manual swapped it, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. I mean, it's just a normal DeLorean 5-speed manual. You know, had everything bolted in.
But it has a gated manual shifter.
It has a gated shifter, yeah. And so, I made all this, too.
That's really cool. But, okay, what else on the powertrain?
So it's got cams, headers. It's got heads from the Eagle Premier. You know what that is?
I have no idea.
So, like, back in the 80s, there was this agreement between Chrysler and Renault, and they kind of partnered together to make cars.
Okay.
And they made a car called the Eagle Premier. It was also the Dodge Monaco, too. But it had a PRV V6 like this.
Okay.
But it was, like, the last version. It was, like, the best one. And so they did a lot better, like, you know, flow dynamics in the head. It's a much better flowing head.
Okay.
Even though it's from, like, an 80s passenger car. So, at least in the community, you might call it a high flow head.
Okay.
But you can pick them up at junkyards for $50.
Holy crap.
It's fantastic.
Okay.
So it's got the better flowing heads. They've been poured and polished. It's full EFI conversion. You know, distributorless ignition. It's got LS1 coils for the ignition. Trying to think what else.
Exhaust?
Yeah, custom-made exhaust.
Okay.
I just made it in my garage with my welder.
My first
welding project. But it's actually a Camaro muffler. It's a 70s Camaro muffler.
This is just like a parts bin of everything across everything.
Oh, it is.
It's so cool.
Well, the reason I did it that way is because it's cheaper. It's way cheaper to do it.
Okay.
And the DeLorean was kind of a parts shelf car to begin with.
Yeah.
So, it's fine.
So, a lot more than 130 horsepower.
A lot more, yes.
But no, nothing confirmed, but like 200s?
250 maybe?
So
I don't know.
Percentage increase-wise, that is significant.
It is significant.
That is significant.
Really, the biggest problem with... So, the PRV is not a terrible engine. Everybody acts like it's a horrible, terrible engine.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't necessarily believe it's the best engine in the world. You know, you'll get some people that are like DeLorean fans that are like, it's the best engine in the world. You know, it's not. It's not.
But
it's
works.
An interesting engine because it's an odd fire. It's an odd fire V6.
Oh, really?
So, it's, you know, the cylinders kind of almost fire in pairs. There's a space between two cylinders firing. It's strange.
That is weird.
Yeah.
Is that why it sounds so...
That's just why it sounds like a different kind of sound, you know? Like, most V6s kind of sound like a lawnmower or a sewing machine, you know? This idle kind of sounds like a V8.
Yeah, when you pulled up, I was like, whoa, what is that?
Yeah.
And driving away when we were heading to the parking lot, it sounded really, really good.
Yeah.
So how hard was it to manual swap a DeLorean.
So the hardest part is that automatic and manual DeLoreans actually have different distinct frames.
Like the body frame, like the well, chassis.
The chassis is different.
What?
So the little hole where the shifter goes into, there's like a little shelf where it sits. Yeah. On the manual cars, that shelf is higher.
Oh.
So I had to fabricate a new shelf that bolts into the frame.
What?
So if you were to take off the center console, yeah, you'd see a couple bolts here,
okay,
that I've added in.
Yeah.
And then there's a new sort of shelf that's been added.
So you just found a 5-speed manual out of some other DeLorean.
Yep.
And
yep,
just retrofitted all of it.
Yeah, so I've got a friend in Georgia, that's where I'm from. He's actually electric converting his car.
Oh, wow.
So when he like made the announcement on like the DeLorean forums that he's electric converting it, I was like, dude, can I buy your transmission? So I've actually bought his transmission and all of the, you know, shift linkage, pedal box, and all that stuff. And I bought that for less than what I sold my automatic for.
Holy
so I actually
crap.
Made money on the swap.
And you made the car much more desirable in every single way.
Yeah, and made money on it.
That's awesome. And this is a custom gated manual plate.
Yeah, yep. So I made that on a laser cutter, and this shift ball, I made that too.
Nice.
It just looks a lot better. Stock, it just has like a leather boot, which, you know, pretty typical for the time, but like a lot of the coolest cars had gated manuals back in the day.
Absolutely.
So
as a former gated R8 owner,
it's the best.
I relate. Although my girlfriend at the time was asking, like, so what makes it better? And like, how do you explain to somebody who doesn't know cars why gated manuals
are
better?
It just looks cool.
I was just like, it looks cool. She goes, okay, is it faster? Well, not really. Actually, it's a little bit slower.
It is.
The why? Yeah. It's just better. Don't worry.
Yeah. And it scratches up the shift rod here. You know, but
it's that's unique. That's definitely a cool touch.
Yeah.
This is fascinating. This is hanging out and talking to a real engineer.
Yeah.
I am not a real engineer at all. No.
Some days I don't feel like I'm a real engineer.
Scratch. So the steering wheel is also different.
Yes. So this is from a Renault Alpine.
Okay.
Or Alpine, if you want to say it correctly. So the Alpine also had a PRV V6, but they were only sold in Europe mainly. And they had, they were like Alpine rally cars that had an engine very similar to this.
Okay.
Is really what I based my engine off of.
Okay.
Except they were carburetors back in the day.
Gotcha.
But this is an Alpine steering wheel.
Okay.
And I just love it because it's period correct.
Yeah.
It's got the cool brushed metal spokes.
Yeah.
And it looks like it belongs in here.
Yeah. It looks like it's, I haven't been inside a DeLorean ever before, and it,
yeah,
that doesn't stand out.
The stock steering wheel looks like it's something off of like a 80s Camry. It just doesn't look cool, you know.
Oh, and the other big thing, we're sitting on the Recaro seats.
Yes, yeah. These are Recaro Expert L's. So they're actually new. They're made to be like a modern interpretation of like the old Recaro LS and LX seats. They're a little different, but they kind of have that old school style.
I mean, they're comfortable. They look awesome.
Yeah, they look like they belong in here,
yeah,
which was the idea. The stock seats, I mean, they're nice, but they have no side bolstering at all. So.
So how long have you had this car for?
I've had this car for almost 6 years.
6 years?
Yeah.
So you bought it 6 years ago. How many miles? You've got, this is 40 years old, you said. It's turning 40 this year.
In July, yeah.
In July.
Yeah.
It's got 26,000 miles on it.
Yeah.
So did it like cost a lot to buy because it was really pristine?
I actually only paid $5,000 for it because it actually was sitting for 20 years in a garage. Just nobody ever drove it or changed the oil. It just was mothballed.
So sort of like a barn find.
Yeah. It was actually in a car museum, believe it or not. So this was in Georgia.
Okay.
And this was a car museum where they had like Duesenbergs and Packards, and they even had a Tucker. So they had a lot of, you know, high dollar, really valuable cars.
Yeah.
And they were kind of more into like the, you know, the pre-war, you know, big kind of like Gatsby kind of cars.
Mm-hmm.
And they just happened to have this DeLorean, and it was in their like storage area. And so I saw that, I was like, oh, that's so cool. I got to have that.
Can I buy it? They're like, sure, $5,000.
Like, exactly. Yeah.
Wow.
So, and they, because the thing of it is like that car museum collection, they have a curator.
Okay.
And he always wanted the family who owned the collection to restore this car.
Okay.
And they never really got around to doing it.
And
then he was like, if we sell it to Jace, he'll put it back on the road.
Yeah.
And so that's one of the reasons why they wanted to sell it to me, because I would put it back on the road.
What else have you, any like body work or any suspension stuff or anything?
So it's got full KW suspension, which is phenomenal. The KW suspension is new as of, I think, last year.
Okay.
And I've had like 4 or 5 different suspensions on this car in my time of ownership. This is by far the best.
Oh, wow.
It's like fully adjustable, and you know the coilover setup, it's really
handles
good.
A bit better.
Yeah, it handles so much better. It's lower too. From the factory, they sit too high.
They look
kind of monster trucky from the factory.
Factory wheels?
Factory wheels, yep.
But new tires.
Yeah. New
tires,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Factory tires would not be good for.
It's very hard to find tires for these cars.
Oh, really?
It's a 14 in the front and a 15 in the rear.
Oh, boy.
And it's hard to find like a matching tread set.
Oh, man. So, that must be weird. Do people put aftermarket wheels on DeLoreans?
They do.
Probably.
I'm torn. I really want to put a classic set of like BBS basket weaves on it.
Oh, that would be cool.
But they are
a lot of money.
They're a lot of money. And I like the stock wheels, I don't know. I'm torn. I kind of flip-flop back and forth whether I'm going to do it or not.
Is there anything else you have outstanding that you still want to do that you're not quite happy with? Or is this like approaching the level of your vision for the car?
So there's a few small things that I'd like to do. There's a couple front suspension upgrades that I want to make.
Okay.
The lower control arms in these cars are notorious for breaking.
Oh.
So it's got an upper A arm, but the lower control arm is like it's like a stick. It's stupid. So like under, you know,
heavy cornering,
braking, and stuff. The caster moves all around because the wheel kind of does this.
Okay.
And it's really dumb. So I want to design some lower A arms.
Okay.
That stiffen up the front suspension. I'd also like to add a rear sway bar.
Okay.
And these are all things that, you know, parts that don't exist.
Yeah.
I want to come up with them and actually sell them.
Oh, okay.
So that'd I've got awesome. A little like DeLorean speed parts business. So I sell these shift gates and I sell these steering wheel adapters too.
Oh, nice. All right. Yep. If you have a DeLorean and you want a gated shifter or a steering wheel.
Yeah.
I'll link it below.
Yeah, let me know.
That will go in the description.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there anything you hate about this car?
It gets a lot of attention. And there, I don't really know if I'm an introvert or not. Some days I feel like I am or not.
Oh, and a lot of engineers are introverts.
Yeah. And so there are some days, you know, when you go to the gas station and you just get swarmed by people.
Yeah.
And you're there for 30 minutes and you're like,
okay.
I want to go home.
And you got to be nice to people and stuff.
Yeah.
I got a glimpse of that when we parked right when you pulled up.
Yeah.
What, like 6 or 7 people all came out? They were losing their minds.
Yeah.
Literally 15 minutes ago, we had a green Aventador SVJ parked in the same spot. I don't think anybody went and looked at it. Like, another green Lambo. And this DMC, this DeLorean, everybody lost their minds over.
And I think because this car, you know, it appeals to non-car people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because everybody, it's like a cultural icon.
Yeah,
it's like Superman,
absolutely.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So when people see a DeLorean, you know, they're like, they've probably never seen one before. So like, I don't want to be a jerk and be like, I gotta go, I don't have time for this. Because they'll probably never get a chance to see another one.
Kudos to you for being, I mean, you were super generous, let people take pictures in the
yeah.
car. Yeah,
yeah.
Big respect there. But
yeah.
I can see how that could get tiring for sure.
It does. Sometimes I'm just not in the mood for it.
Yeah.
That
actually happened with the i8. People, is that a concept car? I'm like, no, it's production.
Yeah.
Like, this is a real car. And they're like, is it a Lamborghini? I'm like, no, there's a BMW badge up front.
Well, a lot of people think that, you know, don't really know what a DeLorean is, they think the whole car in the movie, what the whole thing was a prop.
Oh.
So they'll say, oh, you built a DeLorean? Then I had to sit there and explain it. I was like, no, it was a real car. They made like 9,000 of them in 81 through 83.
It was only, it's 2 years of production ever.
Like 2.5 years.
2.5 years?
Of.
Okay.
The last year was kind of weird because, believe it or not, have you ever heard of Big Lots? The company,
the
store.
Yeah,
Big Lots. So their parent company actually bought out DeLorean when they went out of business.
Oh, really?
And they like produced and sold the 83 year models. So if you have an 83, it was
a Big Lots
built by Big Lots,
big department store thing.
Yeah, but the company was called Consolidated International.
Okay.
And they're in the business
like
of like
generic parent.
Yeah,
company.
So they buy like failing businesses and liquidate their assets. That's how they. That's how they get like their off-brand Cheez-Its.
Gotcha.
And the Big Lots stores.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
What made, so were you just a big fan of the car originally or the movies, or what made you really want to get this?
Honestly, it was because I saw that car just sitting there. Like,
oh, okay.
So in high school, I had a 53 Ford Coupe. That was my first car. And I really liked it, but I wanted something that was more sporty.
Okay.
And so I sold it and I wanted to get something like this. But I was not once thinking DeLorean.
Okay.
Because I just thought I'd never be able to find one if I wanted one. So I just didn't even consider it. So I looked mainly at like Corvettes and, you know, Lotuses and that type of stuff, you know.
So this is almost a happy coincidence then.
Oh, absolutely. Okay. I was not looking for one.
Gotcha.
It sort of found me.
Oh, wow.
And then what I realized, like, this is the perfect car for me. You know, I love the design of the car, like the Italia DiGiorio design.
Yep.
I love that they're not horribly expensive yet. They're starting to get
starting to go up?
They've tripled in price since I bought mine.
When you got it for $5,000, was that market value?
Market value is probably about 12.
Oh, okay.
Probably.
Okay.
But I mean, it looked like it had been sitting for 20 years. But now, that same car now would probably be about 25.
Oh, wow.
Maybe a little more.
Okay, so they have been going up.
One sold on Bring a Trailer like last week for, I think it was like almost $70,000.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Wow.
So,
But
it was like a Concours perfect car, which this one isn't, you know.
Yeah.
But,
well, I mean, you drive it, you enjoy it,
and all
that sort of stuff. So you've also got the new Bluetooth setup, right?
Yeah, I just put that in.
Music.
So in my entire time of ownership, I never had a working radio. So I had the stock Craig radio, which, you know, Craig is like the discount bargain bin, horrible, you know, tape cassette player that you buy at CBS, you know. That's what they're known for. But anyway, this is a retro sound radio, which what's super cool about them is it looks like a classic radio from the 80s, but it's modern.
Yeah.
You know? So it's got a modern amp, modern Bluetooth. I've got like a dial control here.
Yeah, that's really
actually
cool.
3D printed that. Yeah. It was like a little holder.
Fits in. So this was like an ashtray.
That was an ashtray, yeah. Okay. Yep. Yep.
That's awesome. So it sounds like something.
And it's like practical. You open the front trunk.
Yeah.
It's not deep, but it's enormous.
Yeah. The stupid part about it is it's so shallow, you can't stand up a bottle of Windex in it.
Oh. Okay, so maybe not that practical.
So everything has to go sideways.
You can put very big flat things in there. It's good for transporting
paintings. We've gone on road trips in this thing, like weekend trips. There's plenty of space. Like this rear parcel shelf is great. You know, you can put a lot of luggage back here.
And
that's one of the things I didn't like about the C8. Like, I got to drive a C8.
Yeah.
It has no interior space. Like, this car, you can hop in, throw your backpack right here, and go.
Yeah.
You know?
The C8, because the, well, I felt even the C7. But I got in, and I'm a bigger guy. I'm like, well, okay, that's it. It felt a lot more exotic, supercar-y, less of the.
That's a Nissan Murano Cross Cabriolet.
Oh, yeah.
Those are rare.
That's a rare car.
That's really rare.
There's like a Facebook page of people that love them and love spotting them.
Let's make a crossover convertible.
I know.
Who thought? Range Rover did the same thing. The Evoque Cross Cabriolet thing, yeah.
There's all kinds of niche car Facebook pages that I love. My favorite is the Brown Car Appreciation Society.
What about, actually, Syed, we're at Platinum Motor Cars. He ordered a brown Performante Spider.
Wow.
And when he told me, I was like, are you kidding me? He goes, trust me, it'll look good. And it did look actually pretty good. Yeah. I think a brown
C8 comes in like a root beer kind of brown color.
Zeus.
Is that what it's called?
Zeus Bronze.
Okay.
Zeus Bronze. I actually really like it. I saw one at Spring Mountain. I'm like, big fan. It also actually is really funny that you cleaned this with refrigerator cleaner.
Yeah.
Literally, because it's stainless steel, right?
Yeah. So when I first got it, I went into Home Depot because I had never bought stainless steel cleaner before. And I walked in and I was like, where's the stainless steel cleaner? And the guy's like, what are you cleaning? I'm like, a DeLorean. And he just looked at me like, are you kidding me? And I'm like, no. And then he hands me a can with a giant stainless refrigerator on it. Yeah. I'm like, okay, this is my life now.
Yeah. That's hilarious.
So I've tried all the stainless steel cleaners. So if you need recommendations for your toaster, let me know.
How to maintain stainless steel. Well, do you wash it like normally? Or is it?
Yeah, you wash it normally, but then you have to do like the stainless cleaner.
Oh, okay.
And then about once a year, or maybe a little more than that, you regrain the car. So you get like a Scotch-Brite pad, and you just go the length of the car.
It's like sanding a table and refinishing it.
Yeah, but my favorite part is there's actually guys that work for DMC now. Because, you know, like DMC is kind of more of like a parts and restoration company now.
Okay.
But there's, you know, you can take your car to a DMC dealership and literally pay them to scratch your car.
What the?
Because they'll regrain your car.
What the?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yep. And there's professional DeLorean regraining people.
That is hilarious. That's a crazy profession to be in.
Yeah, yeah. And there's this one guy that he just flies all over the world.
Uh-huh.
Regraining and doing PDR and DeLoreans.
That's crazy.
And that's his job.
Wow. Yeah. I guess dents, you just...
Yeah.
No. This does get a lot of... I've seen people just kind of looking over. People are just standing over there like, what is that? Yeah.
So when,
look at that guy.
Yeah. And it's crazy because, you know, I've noticed... You know, because I've been around classic cars my whole life. You know, most people, like at car shows, you know, they'll walk up politely with their hands behind their back. They'll say, oh, man, hey, nice car.
Yeah.
You know, but DeLoreans, they just lose it.
They, you know, no composure anymore. They're like, oh, my God.
But the worst part is like, people want to touch it. You know, they want to touch the stainless. And I come back from a car show, and there are handprints everywhere.
Oh, come on. Respect people's cars. Don't touch them.
But it's something about DeLoreans. People just... Oh, and too, like, you know, at car shows, you know, you display the car with the doors open, people will just get in it.
Yep, I've seen that. That happened to me in the i8. I had an auto show. People just climbed in. I'm like, hey, that's my car. Please don't do that.
So, I don't know. People just forget their car show etiquette when they're around these things, but it's probably because they're excited. You know? I don't want to be a jerk about it.
Yeah, it is a cultural icon. That's cool.
Yeah.
Glad you're driving it. And these are some fascinating projects. This is properly engineered.
Oh, yeah.
Really cool stuff going on, mechanical stuff. You know what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. So, I will link your Instagram below.
Yep.
Ramblin_DMC.
Mm-hmm.
We'll link the parts for DeLorean speed parts stuff.
Yep.
And that's what it's like to own a DeLorean and really start to customize it. This is awesome.
Yeah.
Thanks so much, dude.
You got it.
All right. I will try to drive this thing. We'll do the review. This is awesome. This is very awesome. Thanks.